Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to God's house for worship today. It's good to be here with you again. We welcome those guests who are with us here today as well. Thank you for being here. Some faces that we haven't seen in a while, welcome back. Glad to worship with you again too. If you're worshiping with us online or watching our worship videos, may this time in God's word be a great blessing to you. As we pray, it's a blessing to all of us. We share in God's word and return our praise and thanks to Him. We are continuing in the joy and the message of Easter this morning, because Easter isn't just a holiday that we celebrate once and then forget about. The meaning of Easter and the joy of Easter continue with us throughout our year, throughout the rest of our lives. Jesus is risen, and so we will too. And that gives us a wonderful message to share, a meaningful message to share. And that is the theme for our worship service today. As Jesus sent out his disciples after his resurrection to share the good news of salvation and eternal life with him, so we continue to carry out that meaningful message to the world today. And we'll look for that theme to run through our worship service and our hymns and our sermon message as well. And we'll also be celebrating the Lord's Supper during our worship service today. So We ask our guests and our members, too, to take a look at our scriptural practice of closed communion, which you can find summarized on page 17. Just a reminder, first of all, what it is that we're sharing together, that this is Jesus' true body and blood, as he says in his word, and that we join together with those who have professed their unity with us in the faith by being members of a Wells or ELS church to come forward and receive the Lord's Supper together. And if we haven't had an opportunity yet to sit down and make sure that that unity in the faith exists, that we truly share a faith together, we ask that you'd wait until we have the time and the opportunity to sit down and make sure that we're following Jesus' commands as closely as we can. So there's a little more detailed summary of that on page 17 if you'd like to read through that. But we'll begin our service then with our first hymn. It's hymn 401 in the blue hymnals in front of you. We'll sing, "There is a Fountain." May that Lord be with us today and richly bless our worship together. please stand? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Dear friends, let us approach God with a true heart and confess our sins, asking Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to forgive us. Lord of life, I confess that I am by nature dead in sin, for faithless worrying and selfish pride, for sins of habit and sins of choice, for the evil I have done and the good I have failed to do, you should cast me away from your presence forever. O Lord, I am sorry for my sins. Forgive me for Jesus' sake. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. In His great mercy, God made us alive in Christ even when we were dead in our sins. Hear the word of Christ through His called servant. I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, by the humiliation of your Son, you lifted up this fallen world from the despair of death. By his resurrection to life, grant your faithful people gladness of heart and the hope of eternal joys. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. You and I have a very meaningful message to share as we carry out the joy and the good news of Jesus' resurrection to the world. Not everyone will be excited to hear it, as the apostles soon encountered. And to many people, it doesn't sound like a message of love, because it begins with the law and ends with the gospel. It comes with a call for repentance and then gives us the forgiveness of sins, as we see outlined by Peter and the other apostles as they went out to share this message. We hear from Acts chapter 3 after the apostles healed a man who had been unable to walk. While the man held on to Peter and John, all the people were astonished and came running to them in the place called Solomon's Colonnade. When Peter saw this, he said to them, "Fellow Israelites, why does this surprise you? Why do you stare at us as if by our own power or godliness we made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus. You handed him over to be killed, and you disowned him before Pilate, though he had decided to let him go. You disowned the holy and righteous one and asked that a murderer be released to you. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. We are witnesses of this. By faith in the name of Jesus, this man whom you see and know was made strong. It is Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him that has completely healed him, as you can all see. Now, fellow Israelites, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did your leaders, but this is how God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, saying that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, then, and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord, and that he may send the Messiah who has been appointed for you, even Jesus." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our psalm of the day is printed for you in your bulletins. We'll join together in singing Psalm 150 in unison. Our second lesson this morning is from 1 John chapter 1 and a little bit of chapter 2 also, as John introduces this theme of light and darkness in his first letter and tells us about the wonderful message of repentance and forgiveness that we have to share, a joyful message with the people of the world around us, for all people of the world, because everyone's sins were forgiven by Jesus in his death on the cross. John writes, "This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him, yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make him out to be a liar, and his word is not in us. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand and we'll sing in unison our gospel acclamation. Our gospel lesson this morning covers the same event that we heard about last week, this time from Luke's perspective, from Luke's gospel, Luke chapter 24, verses 36 through 49, Jesus appearing to his disciples, the apostles, in that locked room the first Easter evening. Here we focus on the fact that he gives them this message to proclaim, a meaningful message to proclaim, not just to the people of Jerusalem, but they were going to be his witnesses even throughout the world as we continue to share the witness of the disciples in God's word today. We read from Luke 24. "While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, 'Peace be with you.' They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, 'Why are you troubled? And why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have.' When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe, because of joy and amazement, he asked them, 'Do you have anything here to eat?' They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, 'This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms.' Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, 'This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. And repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
Please be seated for our hymn of the day. Today we'll sing 459, "Christ the Lord is Risen Again."
Thank you.
peace of our Lord Jesus be with you. Amen. The sermon text we're focusing on is our second lesson today from the Apostle John's first letter. Please listen again to these words that he writes to us. This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make him out to be a liar, and his word is not in us. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. This is God's word for us this morning. Dear servants of the Most High God, there's a lot of talk this past week about light and darkness. Do you remember? Seems like it was a long time ago already. Monday, there was a very big event that caught the attention of many people around our nation, many people around the world even. If I had a dollar for every time I heard the word totality, I'd have quite a pocket full of cash right now. I stepped outside and tried to look from here in Stoddard on Monday. It wasn't that great of a show to see the solar eclipse. Not only did we have only, 80% coverage, something like that, in this area, but it was also quite cloudy. I think I saw a few people who had snapped a quick picture as the partial crescent of the sun kind of peeked between the clouds, but it wasn't much of a sight here. However, if you traveled to the path of totality that went across a good swath of our nation, or maybe turned on the TV as we did at our house to watch some of the videos of the different groups celebrating in different places, the different events that were going on, it really does get dark, doesn't it? When the shadow of the moon blocks out the entire light of the sun, it's like nighttime in the middle of the day. It's truly an incredible sight and a moving experience. As I mentioned, we had the television on at our house and we were watching the different kind of watch parties that were going on across our nation in several different big cities. And it's kind of interesting to me listening to those reporters who had the unenviable task of sitting there where they clearly just wanted to be staring up at this awesome sight that was going on in the sky above, and they're required to fill roughly 4 minutes of supernatural darkness, almost, with, whatever they could think of to say, basically. And I kind of had to laugh because so much of it was just unnecessary fluff. Come on, we just want to see the site. We just want to see what's happening in your area. But one of those reporters that I was listening to, he talked about what a neat experience it was. He was clearly emotionally and even physically moved by what was going on. And he described to the people in the listening audience how so much of the year and so much of what his news station is busy talking about divides us and worries us about really, when you look at the solar eclipse, what are really small things, the rising crime rate, the rising inflation, the upcoming election, things that pull us apart in different directions. And here, for just a few minutes, all these people gathered from different corners of the country, corners of the globe even, were gathered together and brought together and unified by this singular focus as they all passed for a few moments in the shadow of complete darkness. The darkness brought them together. Of course, their focus was that shadow of the moon as it crossed over the sun in the skies above. Now, it's not that I was expecting this TV reporter to give a real meaningful message, especially not a message about a powerful God who can and does do wonderful and amazing things for us. But it was kind of painful for me to sit there and listen to these people get to get paid to fill the airways with their noise. People who clearly felt that this was a special, a spiritual, meaningful experience, and yet none of them had a clue what it means or what message we should be taking away from it. Sure, they could tell you how a solar eclipse happens, where the sun, the moon, and the earth are all lined up in a perfect straight line for just a few moments, and the shadow of the moon falls onto just a small swath of the earth. They can tell you how it happens, but they don't know why and what it means and why it's important and why it happens here. We have that message. We have the meaningful message that we need to share. It tells us why, when awesome celestial events take place like a solar eclipse, why it feels meaningful. The wonderful message that we have to share tells us why and who causes those things to happen and why. And the people of the world around us, they are hungry. They are hungry for a message that has some meaning, because so many people in our world today feel like their lives have no meaning. Like it doesn't matter what happens and where they're going, and they have questions about why we're here, why we exist, what life is all about. And we need to make sure we use every opportunity, like the apostles did, to share the good news with them of why life has meaning, of who gives it meaning, and who gives us the forgiveness of sins that we so desperately need. John uses this theme of light and darkness that have such a strong impression on us, especially if you think back in those days when incandescent light bulbs were not something that they had access to. Light and darkness were very, very different things and kind of changed the very way that people would live. God created light. The Bible tells us that very clearly. It comes from Him. We human beings still have a whole lot to learn about light. Is it a particle or is it a wave? Sometimes it behaves like a particle. Sometimes it behaves like a wave. We can't even answer these simple questions about light. How does light travel through the vacuum of space? As you get closer and closer to the speed of light, does time slow down? All these theories out there about light. And even if science never answers these questions, our God who created light, He certainly knows. Not only did He make light and declare, "Let there be light," but John tells us in these verses that He Himself is light. He is light itself. That's why it makes sense that He could call light into existence on the very first day of creation, even though He didn't create the sun, moon, and stars until the fourth day of creation. That's right. So 3 days went by. 3 days with a morning and an evening, with no sun to rise and no sun to set, and yet God gave the light and took the light away even on those days, because He Himself is the light. He can do these awesome and wonderful things. And the Apostle John, along with several other Bible writers, wrote quite a bit about light and darkness, but John particularly loves this theme. It's a major theme in all of his writings, from his gospel all the way to the book of Revelation that he wrote. Light and darkness appear again and again, including in his first letter. He wrote about the light that unites us all in fellowship with God and in fellowship with one another. And he wrote about this unity that is more than just a fuzzy feeling that disappears as quickly as the sun comes out from behind the shadow of the moon. This fellowship is what the whole world is really looking for. and what absolutely everyone in this world needs to find. This is what every person in the world has needed since the creation, since the very beginning. It's what our God made us for fellowship with Him. Think of what He wanted to have with Adam and Eve in the garden, and then what they broke by falling into sin. They separated themselves from Him, but God wanted fellowship. God wanted unity. God wanted a relationship with them. This is why we human beings, all human beings, deep down hunger and thirst for that fellowship with God. Some people spend their whole lives looking for it and never find it. Many people fall into despair, often without even recognizing what it is they're missing. Many people are offered it because it's God's free gift to us, and without recognizing the value of what's being handed to them, they toss it away. That need that we all have deep inside of us is for fellowship. Fellowship with one another, with other human beings. We are social creatures. But most of all, fellowship with God. Now, we use this word fellowship in a number of different ways. Here, it's a churchy word, and we use it several different ways even here at church. But it can be easily misunderstood because of the different ways that we use it. Perhaps the way that we use it the most often in our church is just for spending time together. We call that fellowship quite often. Just enjoying a cup of coffee and some crackers and cheese after our worship service while you chat with a friend about anything, about the upcoming plans for the week or what you did last weekend. You may even be doing that here at St. Matthew's in what we have lovingly called our fellowship hall. But truthfully, not everything that happens in a fellowship hall, not everything that happens with a cup of coffee in your hand, is truly fellowship. This word itself we use when we talk about the doctrine of fellowship. This doctrine or teaching means that we worship together and work together to spread the gospel strictly with Christians who agree with what the Bible teaches. And if they don't, we warn them kindly, show them what God's word says, and the doctrine of fellowship from God's word says if they won't teach and believe what the Bible says, eventually we'll have to separate ourselves from them and not worship and work with them to spread the gospel. It's a very difficult challenge for us as Christians. When we join with our fellow Christians in our work and mission, when they share God's word and teaching of God's word with us, we're not just walking along in a similar direction, high-fiving each other as we go, or simply standing with someone enjoying some time drinking our coffee. But fellowship is truly walking together, working together, sacrificing for one another, selflessly giving of ourselves to serve this common goal, this common work, this common mission that we have, which is to spread God's kingdom, to do the work of God's kingdom. And if we understand fellowship this way, it helps us appreciate what John is offering to us in these verses. Not just fellowship with other Christians, but fellowship with God Himself. That doesn't just mean that He is with us, He gives us His presence, that He blesses us while He's among us. But fellowship means that we work with God, and He works with us, both of us sacrificing and giving and supporting and encouraging each other in our work. God is, after all, giving and sacrificing for us, giving us His Holy Spirit as He gave to His apostles to do great miracles and to carry out this mission. And we are sacrificing for the Lord and giving of our time and talents and abilities, our financial gifts to do the work of God's kingdom. This is what fellowship with God is like, working with Him, and there's nothing else like it in the entire world. But there's a problem. John says in these verses very clearly, God is light, in Him there is no darkness at all. And the original language, those words there are very strong. It really says, in Him there is absolutely no darkness, there is not one bit God is holy. He's perfect and sinless. He's always loving. In fact, the Bible says he is love itself. He is always truthful. In fact, the Bible says he is truth itself. He does not change. He will not change. God is always good. Now, we wouldn't think that should be a problem, but it is. It's a problem for us because we are not light. We come from the darkness of this sinful world. By nature, we are filled with darkness. And what fellowship can darkness have with light, the Bible asks. Our sinful words and sinful actions make us ashamed to step into the light of God's presence because it exposes our sinfulness. So we can't simply just step out into the light of God's presence and shamelessly declare, well, I've got nothing to worry about. I'm a pretty good person. I try to help people out. I help my neighbor when he needs a hand. I give something to help the poor and the needy when I can afford it during the holiday season. But we are fools to think that we can have fellowship with God on our own, that light has anything to do with darkness. We're lying to ourselves. We're deceiving ourselves and sadly deceiving people around us too. If we lead them to think that somehow by our actions, by our good works, we can gain fellowship with God who is light. It is a lie. It's a cruel deception, and many people have deceived themselves into believing that it's true, that it can happen. We have to get rid of that darkness of sin, or we cannot stand in the light. And John tells us very clearly how it's done in these verses. He says, if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. And that word purify then goes back to verse 7, where it tells us it is the blood of Jesus, his Son, God's Son, that purifies us from all sin. The blood of Jesus is God's atoning sacrifice that takes away the stain of all of our sins, not just the sins of Christians, but the sins of the entire world. He won forgiveness for all of them, and that's why we have a meaningful message to share, because we get to tell them not if, not maybe, not someday, but your sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus our Savior. They are taken away just as sure as mine are too. When we are purified from all of our sins by Jesus' blood, then we no longer need to be afraid of stepping into the light. In fact, we'll rejoice to step into the light because it'll show that it's actually God who has been busy doing the wonderful things in our lives. It doesn't bring glory to us, it brings glory to God when Christians purified by Jesus' blood step into the light and their works are put on display. We know that God is doing great things in our lives. The love and kindness that we show to others in so many ways. The light shows to us and to others that God is the one working in our lives to do these wonderful things. And we see it and we rejoice. Other people around us see it and rejoice too. As we walk in the light, as he is in the light, it will be seen plainly that what we have done has been done in the sight of God, Jesus told Nicodemus in John chapter 3. Our lives become like signs, like the eclipse, that God is at work among us. When the moon blocks out the light of the sun for a few minutes across our country, we should stop and pay attention. Because those people who were talking on the television, they're right. These things don't happen by accident. It is a miracle that clearly the hand of God is involved in. It takes precise alignment of massive celestial bodies that we have absolutely no control over. But God said on day 4, when he created the sun, moon, and stars, he said in Genesis chapter 1, let them serve as signs to mark sacred times and days and years. The events, the things that happen in the skies above and the sun, moon, and stars, they have for thousands of years been markers of time and signs of the time. God put them up there for us to stare at. And we human beings are the only creatures that we know of for whom it matters and for who care about it. God made those things to tell us a message. It's like a big celestial clock up there, and the clock is ticking, and the clock is chiming. The time is almost up. The Bible says in the last days the sun will be darkened, and there will be wars and rumors of wars, and there will be earthquakes in various places. Of the basic list of the signs of the last days, we had three of them in the past week, at least three of them, that I heard about in the news. God knows how to do these things. He's the only one that can do them, and he does them for a reason. He tells us in his word. The sun was also darkened for a few hours on Good Friday when Jesus gave his life on the cross for our salvation. And there was an earthquake that day too, an earthquake that shook the city of Jerusalem, and tombs broke open and rocks split apart. And at that time there were some people who saw what happened and felt the earthquake and felt the sun, the light of the sun, go out. And some of those people got that message. We hear what the centurion, the Roman centurion, the Roman soldiers said. Surely this was the Son of God. God's been delivering messages with earthquakes and by turning out the light of the sun for thousands of years. And many people have missed it. Many people don't know the message, don't know how to understand what's going on, but you and I have the correct message to share with them, and it is a meaningful message. God wants a relationship with you. He wants fellowship with you. He wants to work with you as you work with him. And so he sent his son to rescue you, and he's coming back. He's coming back to take believers to be with him in fellowship at home in heaven for all eternity. Amen. Please stand. The Son of God has come and has given us understanding so that we may know him who is true. Jesus Christ is true God and eternal life. Amen. I invite you to join your voice with me this morning in confessing our Christian faith as it's summarized in the words of the Nicene Creed on page 11. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. In one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Please be seated as we give our offerings of thanks to the Lord. I encourage you also to use this time to grab those friendship registers in your pews and sign them and pass them down, please. Please stand and we'll join in the responsive prayer of the church printed in your bulletins. Lord God, in your presence we find fullness of joy, and by your right hand, Christ Jesus, you have won eternal peace. In the midst of our struggles and sorrows in this sinful world, give us peace in the knowledge of our salvation and confident hope in the resurrection of the dead. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, you have made us your children and gathered us into your holy church through the good news of Jesus. Sustain among us the preaching of your holy word and its message of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, in Jesus' name. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give peace and joy to our homes by the new life of Christ's resurrection. Through the forgiveness of sins, restore and strengthen husbands and wives, parents and children. Assure those who live alone that they are also your dearly loved children. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And Almighty God, preserve our nation and its leaders. Preserve order and decency in this fallen world by their hands, and restrain the plans of those who seek to do harm, that we may practice righteousness while we await our eternal peace in heaven. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of all comfort, have compassion on those who are afflicted. Remember and have mercy on especially the members of our congregation, our loved ones who are sick or going through surgeries and healing from surgeries. We thank you, Lord, for blessing them. Watch over all of those in need of your healing and deliverance. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus, by your crucifixion, all sins have been blotted out. Fill us with the blessed refreshment of your bodily presence in the sacrament of the altar. Make our hearts ready in repentance to receive the forgiveness of our sins. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We also pray, O Lord, today that you would bless the calls that we extend for teachers to come and instruct in our Christian day school. We ask that you would fill those positions, those classrooms, in your own time and way, and give us grace and patience to await your perfect timing. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we join to pray as he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord would be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. Lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him
Blessed are you, O Lord of heaven and earth. We praise and thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, and we remember the great acts of love through which he has ransomed us from sin, death, and the devil's power. By his incarnation, he became one with us. By his perfect life, he fulfilled your holy will. By his innocent death, he overcame hell. By his rising from the grave, he opened heaven. Invited by your grace and instructed by your word, we approach your table with repentant and joyful hearts. Strengthen us through Christ's body and blood, and preserve us in the true faith until we feast with him and all his ransomed people in glory everlasting. Amen. It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who by his willing sacrifice on the cross took away the sins of the world, and by his glorious resurrection restored everlasting life. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. And the peace of the Lord will be with you always." Amen.
Thank you.
Please stand for our Thanksgiving prayer and blessing. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His mercy endures forever.
Whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
And the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from all sin.
We give thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us with this saving gift. We pray that through it you will strengthen our faith in you and increase our love for one another. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with his favor and give you his peace.
Amen.
Please be seated for our closing hymn. I believe it's 927, Lord, Dismiss Us with Your Blessing. Good morning again, and thank you all for being here today. It is a joy once again to be gathered in God's house with you. And thank you also to those who came yesterday. We had our church cleaning date, and there were a number of people that showed up to help get some bushes trimmed up, some windows washed. I think the pews that you are sitting on are all freshly washed and cleaned, and lots of hands made for much lighter work. So thank you to everybody who came and helped out with that. There's still plenty more to be done, so if you're saying, I just couldn't make it on Saturday, talk to probably especially Kevin and Ellen, and they'll be able to Kevin and Ellen Semke, and they'll be able to point you to a few projects. Kevin's always got a list of five or six projects that he's working on, and he would love to help out. It is wonderful to work together, as we talked about fellowship in the sermon, and in a small way, washing windows and making sure the doorknobs are clean when we come into church is a wonderful way that you can help out so many people to hear the Word of God. A few announcements I wanted to make. First of all, we're having our call meeting after church today. The two calls we extended back in March were returned. Our goal is to extend two more calls today to fill our classrooms in our school for this coming fall. And so please stick around for that. There are cough in some snacks you can grab. You're welcome to bring those back in here and sit down and grab your seat, save your seat if you want to, and come right back. We'll call that meeting to order as soon as we can. And also, you should have received, or the members of our church should have received an email from me this week letting you know in call news that I also received a call last Sunday after church to come and be a shepherd of the congregation down at Peace Lutheran Church in Trinity, Florida, down in the Tampa area. So I ask that you would please keep me and my family in your prayers. And some of you have already stopped by to talk to me and shared your thoughts and feelings, emails, text messages, phone calls, cards, whatever way you want to contact me. I do love hearing from you and understanding your perspective on how our ministries here at St. Matthew's is going. What are some things that we could improve on and work at more? And to talk about my gifts as well. Should I continue to serve here, or ask the Lord's blessing on serving in a new location? So there's plenty to think about, plenty to pray about, and I appreciate your thoughts and prayers as well. Have a wonderful rest of your day. Enjoy this beautiful weather. I think we're going straight from heating to air conditioning. We'll have to turn the air conditioning on here in just a few minutes. Thank you very much for being here today. God's blessings. Welcome to our guests again, and have a wonderful, wonderful week in the Lord.